I started writing a book. I said we because my mom helped me a lot with my history and memories and everything. 2 years ago, around, it took me a lot of time because not only because of my duties as an anchor and reporter, but because it was hard for me to go back to those memories, to go back and remember when I was 10 and I faced discrimination and racism for the first time in my life.
Hey, GRIO fam, it's your girl, Natasha, and today we are so honored and excited to have Emmy Award-winning journalist Ilia Calderón joining us today on the GRIO. Hi, Ilia, how are you?
Hi, Natasha, thank you for having me. So happy to see you and to speak to you, finally.
Yes, I know. So I've admired you for many years, and it's so wonderful that quarantine has brought us together through Zoom. My first question for you is just, how are you? How are you and your family holding up through this time? That's the most important thing.
Yeah, thank God we are fine. We are okay. We are healthy, which is the most important thing. My daughter, Anna, she's 7, and it just surprises me how good she has handled this situation. She understands. My mother, she's 76 years old. She has asthma and hypertension, and she is with us. And she knows, she's conscious that we need to take care of her, and she's not asking to go and meet friends, and she's okay staying home because she understands the situation.
That's right. So thoughtful. You know, we're a community going through this together.
I think she's too mature for 7, but in some things, in others, she's, you know.
Right, a 7-year-old. You did a good job, Mom. So Ilia, this book that you have written is really, I think it's a pioneering book, because I would say it's one of the first, if not the first, mainstream memoir written by an Afro-Latina. The title is My Time to Speak, Reclaiming Ancestry and Confronting Race. What made you want to tell your story at this point in your career?
I started writing a book. I said we because my mom helped me a lot with my history and memories and everything. 2 years ago, around, it took me a lot of time because not only because of my duties as an anchor and reporter, but because it was hard for me to go back to those memories, to go back and remember when I was 10 and I faced discrimination and racism for the first time in my life, and I couldn't do anything. I couldn't say anything. That situation, I felt helpless, alone, and I was just scared. I couldn't say anything, or I couldn't respond anything to her, to the person that that told me something racist for the first time. And it took me a lot of time to go deep in my memories, in my heart, and, you know, a lot of emotions and a lot of crying. But as I told you at the beginning of our conversation, it's sad that it is timely still, that we have to bring this topic to the table, that we have to have this conversation, and that there's out there is a lot of people that need to be educated about this issue that affects us.
Absolutely. And so, you know, just to take things back for our viewers who may be meeting you for the first time, or who've seen you on TV and didn't know your story, you made history. You were the first Afro-Latina to broadcast as a national anchor on a major Spanish-speaking network, Univision, and you were the first often, you know, and you talk about being the first, but not being the last. Why is it that you were the first Afro-Latina? What's up with media and that you would be the first?
And in 2017, but let me tell you, I was born in a small region in Colombia, abandoned, and where we are like more than 90% Black. That was my little paradise, but it was hard for us. When I was in my first years, we didn't have power. We didn't have electricity. I had to study on candle lights. We had to iron our clothes with a charcoal iron. We didn't have running water. We had to go to the river to wash our clothes and sometimes to take a bath. shower. It was hard, and when I moved to Medellin and faced racism for the first time, and in the same Medellin, that is the city that gave me the opportunity to start working on TV as an anchor, that somebody didn't invite me to a casting because of the color of my skin. And then before moving to Telemundo, to that casting, when Telemundo sent someone to Colombia to do a casting because they were looking for an anchor, they never invited me to that casting because of the color of my skin. Finally, I got the job. I landed the job accidentally because I was on vacation. But I see how opportunities are denied to our people. That's why I say, yes, I'm here, but I don't want to be the only one. When I landed this position in as a main anchor in Univision, I promised myself that I can't be the last one. I can't be the only one. My duty is to open doors and to open windows and make sure that other girls like me have those opportunities, and no one take those opportunities away.
Yes. And you grew up in Colombia, where El Choco, is that the name of the town that you grew up in? Say it again.
El Choco.
El Choco. And so in El Choco, there was just this feeling that, you know, of connectedness. It seemed like being Black was normal. There was a celebration of ancestry. Why do you think that sometimes in Latin American culture, because this is everywhere, I'm Puerto Rican and African American, and so I've even seen it, you know, in Puerto Rico, but why do you think there is a resistance to loving Blackness or to celebrating Blackness?
Well, it all started when the slavery happened in all over Latin America. And the conception that being Black is being less of a person, and the governments that abandon our communities for decades or centuries, it makes, when it's institutional, everybody sees a Black person as less, as the poor, and everybody wants to identify with the white, with the European. And let me tell you something, that racism that exists in our countries migrates with us to the United States. We can see the same thing here in the United States. Everybody that is not Black that come to the United States wants to relate to the white, to the fair skin or lighter skin, in part because of the assimilation, right? So we, the Blacks, are, you know, staying behind opportunities, behind representation. And that's one of the reasons why we need to keep raising our voices and say that we are here. Afro-Latinos, we are around 3 million in the United States. One out of four, according to Pew Research Center, says that has immigrants, says has Afro-Latino roots. So we need more representation among the immigrant community in the United States.
Yes, and you bring up the United States. It was just a couple years ago, you got a nice taste of American racism when you did an interview in Yanceyville, North Carolina with members of the KKK. And it was interesting because your producer told them that a Hispanic, a Latina woman of color was going to be there, but they weren't expecting you with your brown skin, and they called you out of your name. Tell us about that experience.
It was hard, but you know what? That is the racism that our people faces every day on the streets. It was hard to know from like firsthand what happened. What is like raw racism? What is being called names, the N-word? It was the most beautiful thing that he told me that day was the N-word. He called me a mongrel. He threatened to burn me. But it was hard for me to face the reality that everybody faces, like African descendants face every day out there. And knowing that now they feel empowered because they are not judged from the top of the leadership in this country.
Right. And when he called you all of those words, did you, I'm curious if you felt more connected to the African-American community, you know, African descendants here in the United States. We have a unique history, just even though there's racism everywhere, every country has their own history. Did you feel a little bit more connected to the African-American community after that?
Of course, at one point I felt we are all the same. We all come from enslaved people. Our ancestors suffered the same thing. So at that point, I felt what African Americans in the United States been feeling for centuries. Mm-hmm. It was different for us in Latin America. Like, as you said, we all have our own history in our countries. Yesterday, I was reading an article about Blacks in Argentina. Right? That sounds rare because not much people knows about Blacks in Argentina or Chile, and they have Black communities. So we all have different histories, but it's true. I felt more identified with the African Americans in the United States. Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's interesting. So this is kind of a larger discussion about Black identity, but there's some people who say that some Afro-Latinos don't want to call themselves Black, that they don't think they're Black, they want to be different. Did you always call yourself Black? And when did that change, if not?
I always call myself Black. I always identified myself as Black. I was born in Chocó. Chocó is more than 95% Black, so we were all Black for us, and we were proud to be Black. Or Afro-descendants. Always. And even our friends that are lighter skin or that are white in Chocó, they call themselves Black because it was more like the identity of being from Chocó and grow up in that culture and the hips and the dance and the music that comes from Puerto Rico. I grew up with the salsa from Puerto Rico.
Oh yeah.
Los Hermanos Lebron, El Gran Combo, everything. Like, we absorbed a lot from Puerto Rico and Cuba, of course. But yeah, I always identify myself as Black. And let me tell you something. In my book, I talk about this because my daughter, I married a Korean-American guy. And for me, I always had the curiosity on how is she going to identify herself as Asian or as Black. And he took her to the American Girl doll store one day and called me from there and said, like, she doesn't find a doll that looks like her. I said, like, try the South Pacific, maybe Hawaiian. And she said, no, that's not me. That is not me. At the end, they came home with a Black doll. And I was like, but that was her decision to identify as a Black person. And, you know, I couldn't be happier, of course. Not that I don't want her to identify with her Asian roots and she feels proud, but at this moment in her life, she identified with the Black roots.
That's a beautiful thing. That was one of my favorite chapters, actually, was reading about how you and your husband met. The whole courtship. It was this beautiful love story. But again, that showed, you know, boundaries sometimes that people put up, you can surpass those. Those boundaries are not skin deep. There's more there. So
yes, yes. You can choose if you want to focus on the differences, on what you have in common. And we decided to share and give more importance to what we have in common.
Absolutely. I want to ask you one more question, just kind of about this moment in time. As you're watching the news unfold in the United States and really beyond the United States, this call for racial justice, what do you think the Latino community, the Latinx community, should be doing to be allies in this movement. And we know that there are Black Latinos, but for non-Black Latinos, should they be, you know, in what ways should they be caring about what's happening to Black people, whether they're, you know, Afro-Latinos or otherwise?
Absolutely. The first thing is for the non-Black Latinos, they need to educate themselves about the history of African descendants in the United States and in Latin America. Compromise to end the microaggressions about the hair, the comments about the hair, not because you have a grandma that has a little dark skin, you have the right to call someone names or to make fun of someone's skin or someone's hair or someone's nose or a woman's hips. So educate first. Remember that Dr. Martin Luther King always thought about immigrants and how immigrants could benefit from the fight of the civil rights movement. I don't want to compare the discrimination that both groups face, but we are discriminated as well as Hispanics and Latinos. And we need this fight, we need to fight it together. Because when you fight for civil rights, you fight for human rights. And when you win, you're gonna have a better society. So this is not only about Black Lives Matter. This is about a better society. So we need to fight this fight together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely stronger together. So of course, your book focuses on different aspects of race, but also your life as a journalist. And I'm looking at that award behind you. Beautiful. I love the Emmy. It's just
yes.
Position behind you. Can you talk about what it takes to be an award-winning journalist? I mean, what are the habits that you developed that make you courageous in the field? And you've gone all over the world and told stories. What are the habits you've developed that have made you a successful journalist?
Well, a lot has to be with my personality, like not afraid to take any risk. And when you feel the passion and you want to tell those stories, you take risks that you are not even aware of the high risk you're taking. I've been out there. I was in Puerto Rico just a year ago when the protests on the streets, and we were tear gassed, and you know, it was hot and we couldn't eat, you name it. When you want to tell a story, there is nothing that can stop you from doing it. And a lot of discipline. You need to study, you need to read, you need to compromise. A family that supports you. I couldn't be here if it wasn't for my husband. When I travel, he never asks me, when are you coming back? Because he knows. It takes maybe 2 days, maybe a week, maybe a little bit more. And he's an amazing father. So when I leave, I am relieved to have that type of husband and that type of father that is gonna take care of our daughter when I'm not here.
Yeah, so the support is really key. And like you said, discipline and just going at it, because the news never stops.
And since, you know, and when I say family, I'm talking about my mother and my sisters too. When I moved to study in Medellin, they say amongst the three of us, I was a privilege because they sent me to the city to do my high school and my college. And they never complained. They never said, why did you send her and not us? They only supported me and wait for their turn to get out of Chocó and have the opportunity to go to college.
Well, this has been an amazing conversation. I just, you know, it, again, we see people on TV, but reading this particular book, My Time to Speak, there you just see the different experiences that added up to get to this moment, to the platform that you have right now. Just thinking about the future, what is left for Ilia Calderón? You've won the awards, you made history. What are you looking forward to next?
Make sure that we have representation in our screen. I have a compromise of my company, and that is really important for me on making sure that we have more Afro-Latinos working for us. So for next step is making sure that we have more, that I am not the only one, and you know, that will make my career more. And everything hard that I had to face in my career is going to be, it's going to mean something when I see more Afro-Latinas and Afro-Latinos on the screen.
Definitely.
Not only on the screen, as a producer as well, you know, and as an executive.
Right, because that's where the decision makers are the ones who can say yes or no, like you said, with the castings and things like that. So
it's important in the meetings that we bring our stories or we have our point of view when something happens on the streets. It sounds different from a person that has never faced racism. Mm-hmm. So we need to bring our stories and our experiences to those tables, to those conversations.
Mm-hmm. Just a final question for you. Was there ever a moment in your career where you felt really discouraged? And how did you overcome being discouraged in that moment? Because there were a lot of, I mean, you have some stories in this book, but is there one that stands out?
Yeah, when one of my bosses in my former company, I went to a meeting because I was not happy with the job that I was assigned, put me on the morning show, and I didn't want to be a reporter for medical and health because I didn't have any knowledge or passion for the topic. I just prepared myself and I did my best. I cried every single day. My mom used to tell me, do your best because someone is looking at you. Always, someone is looking at you. It happened that Univision was looking at me. But when I went to one of the meetings with that person, he had on his desk a People in Español magazine, and Maria Celeste Arraraz was in the cover. And he asked me, what do you want to do then? And I say, I want to have my own show like her. And he laughed in my face and nodded like, you know, that I was dreaming too high. And well, you know, look at me.
Showed him.
Yes,
right?
yes. I'm not going to say that he pushed me to keep fighting because I had the drive already. Yeah. I didn't let his words bother me or come in my way. I just put them away and kept going. This was my goal and focused on what I wanted to do. And just a few months after, I was hired by Univision.
Like Beyonce says, the best revenge is your paper, your money. I love it. Well, Ilia Calderón, thank you so much. This was wonderful.